Good evening, guys, gals, and non-binary pals. This is Aaron, host of one of the hosts, I guess, of that D&D podcast, and I am bringing us back on an off day again for another game playtest. This time it's not one of Ash's, even though she's here. This is one of Jason's games. So I guess let's all go around and introduce ourselves, and we'll let Jason go last so that they can kind of give us the rundown on the game. So yeah, I already said it. I'm Aaron. She, her pronouns. Been here since the beginning, so you could have been watching me for up to 4 years now, which seems like a lot.
That's a while.
It is. We've been doing this for a long time. Ash, you're up.
What? I thought, okay. Hello, my name is Ash. I use she, her pronouns. I am a streamer and a game designer. And so I hang around and do lots of this role-playing game stream thing. I just got off another game, so I'm like a little bit emotionally exhausted from burning wheel times, but I'm also like super hyped for like weird Etruscan bullshit. So yeah, I'm keen.
Get me? Mm-hmm. Cool. Hi, I'm Emily. I use she, her pronouns. I'm an artist and a filmmaker. I'm also on the screen twice. I'm really noticing this today where I can see the back of my head in Ash's one, and it's very disconcerting.
You should have fun stuff behind your head that only people who are paying really close attention can see.
I should put little eyes on the back of my
little LED little eyes or something, or a horn.
Yeah. That would be great.
Yep, you're up, Jason.
Hi, I'm Jason. I use they, them pronouns, and I made this game, and we're playing it on the internet for the first time. This is really exciting, playing it on the internet for the first time. It's been played a lot offline, but we're going to see how it goes on Roll20. I'm really excited about this group. Emily did art for it, so you might notice some of that. It's good. It's really good. Hopefully you'll be able to see some of that if on Roll20 as it comes up. But yeah, this is Stand in Defiance. This is a game about relationships, desire, intimacy, violence, and the wrath of queer Etruscan gods. That's usually how I pitch it. I just realized today that I could call it Etruscan myth punk or something like that. So yes. Maybe I'm going to start calling it that. Yeah, okay. That or
I'm really excited for the Etruscan queer Etruscan gods and the violins.
Oh yeah, violins. Yeah, they're important instruments to this game. Very intricately mechanically modeled. You'll find. But yeah, that or like be crimes do gay or something like that. So it's gonna be fun.
I feel like be gay do crimes is a genre.
Oh yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm.
It is it's also going to be a good genre too.
Yeah. It's going to be interesting seeing how you adjust, Ash, coming from Burning Wheel to this, because like there's a couple of things they have in common, but aside from that, they're like polar opposites as far as the way the games work.
I had a look through the mechanisms last night, and I'll need pointers on some of the stuff around dice rolling, but at the same time, like, yeah,
read a bit about it. Yes, in practice would be helpful.
I really love this like. I like reading through it. I was like, I love this as a text. Just super cool.
Great. I'm so glad you like it. And with that, if you want, we can get going with the game or just the start of the game.
Let's do that. I want to
play
the game. Sounds good.
Want to play the game, Jason?
Okay, let's do it. So the first thing we should do, just going to my copy of the rules, is we should talk about expectations, boundaries, and preferences. Just what it is that we're sitting down and looking for. If there's anything that we want to like completely rule out or have as a maybe, and if there's anything that we want to definitely see happen in the game. So like for me, the be gay do crimes is a definitely see happen.
Yeah, I think
yes, agreed.
Very yes to smooch.
I think one of the things that really appeals to me that I'm like interested in seeing, you know, a bunch of is the way that we're looking back enough in time that like the setting is like back enough in time that It's kind of, you know, hazy and mysterious in a very specific way that I'm excited about. This idea that we're kind of operating in an area where, you know, myth and reality combine, but also like where like truth and it's that thing of like truth and history being kind of like hazy as well. And so like you get that kind of, by looking back far enough in past like the recorded history, the really like well-recorded history mark, you get that kind of magical realism effect out of just not knowing the very clear finite details. And that's the thing that I'm real keen for.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, same. That and like I would say related to that, I'm very into everything to do with interacting with gods and various kinds of, you know, mythological figures and things like that. That sort of like kind of magic mysteriousness is very, very, very cool. I'm very into it.
Yeah. We talked a little bit before the show about things we're not keen on seeing, and yet I guess transphobia is and sexual assault are the two that are my kind of like no thank you.
We won't need any of that, I think. I don't really see either of those adding much to the game.
The only other one for me is I'm generally fine with like an amount of violent stuff happening, but I tend to kind of get woozy if the violence is described in like very great detail or is like super close up and visceral. That kind of tends to
be like it tends to be medical. The violence becomes too medical is when you struggle.
Okay. Yeah. That makes sense. We can keep it away from that, I think. Yeah. I mean, but if like, violence sometimes as far it does.
Like, as far as like the 300 style like violence, you know, dramatic like legs flying off, that's actually fine. I'm fine with that kind of like really over the top like
cartoonish levels.
The sort of aestheticized violence.
That kind of stuff is fine,
but not like the clinical descriptions of things.
You got it.
Okay, that works. How about you, Aaron?
It doesn't really come up very often, and usually I can deal with it. I almost drowned once, so like people drowning in like that being narrated kind of gives me weird asthma feels, but aside from that I'm good.
Sure.
You know, okay. And the stuff already mentioned.
Yeah, we can stay away from that as well. And one thing that we're also going to do in this game is when anything that seems like remotely close to the things we've talked about right now comes up, and also for like sex and violence in general, because that tends to be sort of at the best of times often a maybe kind of thing, we're always going to ask everyone else if they're down with where we're going before we describe that. So that's one important thing in the game, because aside from that everything's going to move really quickly.
Okay. Cool, sounds good.
Great. Good to me. The other thing I want to mention is I want to make sure that everyone feels comfortable and willing to call a pause or a break whenever you need to. And if you need to pause or break immediately, just interrupt whatever's happening, interrupt whoever's speaking, and we can go to a break right from there.
Yep.
Absolutely.
All good.
Fantastic. So one thing that we haven't actually talked about yet, this game has sort of a GM equivalent role called the High Priestess. Mm-hmm. We never actually mentioned who's doing that.
I was wondering about that.
Yeah.
I was just kind of like, other people might have already made decisions about that.
Nope. We haven't decided that at all.
Yeah. I feel most comfortable with. So here's the problem. Mm-hmm. From my perspective, I feel most comfortable with seeing Jason in the High Priestess role because it's an arbiter role, and so therefore the person who knows the rules best. But I'm aware of the fact that it is less helpful as a playtest if the person writing the game is the one GMing it.
That's true. I think that's probably not going to matter as much for this one, partly just because it tends to be the player role that's starting every single scene and moving everything forwards as quickly as possible.
Okay.
So,
yep.
I'm perfectly happy to do the High Priestess role just because, frankly, it's what we're going to be most comfortable with. It's the most traditional configuration. The other option would be, the other easy option, I think, would be to have all of us kind of
switch it
act
up.
As players and make our own characters and also just sort of pass the role around doing a kind of GM-less thing.
Which I'm cool with, but I know that Emily has struggled with that in some games.
I do tend to struggle with that because my GM skills are better than they used to be, but they're still not super well developed, and so I find it difficult to switch between like those modes in my head quickly. So yes, I would be happy if other people want to hand it around, but I think I would sit out of that one and just be a player in this particular instance.
Okay, Aaron, do you have any strong preferences?
I'm kind of fine with whatever.
I'm
keen to go with the flow either way.
Jason, I don't mind sharing it around and letting Emily sit out of that position. I'm also happy for you to run it completely.
I think it'll probably go most smoothly and most comprehensively for the audience if we just have one person doing it, just because that's sort of the traditional configuration. And then, like, for second and third sessions, we can talk about changing that up maybe as well.
Showcase different play methods.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Well, Jason, if you are happy, I would love to see you do that role. That would be really good.
Great. Then I will. So, continuing to move forwards. Since I'm doing High Priestess, the first thing we need to do, we're going to make some decisions about the game and the world as a group, and then we're going to move from there into creating characters and working on NPCs and stuff like that. So the first thing we need to do is decide what's happening in the world to the community that we want to focus on right now in the moment that we're playing. We're going to choose...
I just wanted to flag this this part of the world, like especially the classification of like feud, catastrophe, and prosperity as like things. I was like, that's such good. That's so good.
Yes.
Yeah.
Agreed. Thanks. So yeah, I'm gonna read that out then. Feud, catastrophe, and prosperity, as Ash just mentioned, are the three things that we're going to choose between. And I think it's probably I'll just like read out the first clause of each one of them. Feud is aggressive competition leaving ruin and resentment in its wake, and we've all got the rules and can read through from there. Catastrophe is accident or divine wrath wreaking havoc and confusion, and prosperity is bounty and wealth bringing joy, power, envy, competition, and tension. So all of these can drive the game in different directions and really introduce complications of their own sorts into what's going on. And it's up to us to sort of decide what kind of tone and direction we want the game to move in now.
Jason, I had a quick procedural question since I'm doing the streaming. Are you okay with me making the playtest materials visible on the stream so people can read along?
Definitely.
Okay, just wanted to check.
Please do, And make sure you get good shots of the art in that as well, because whoever did the art for this, they did a fantastic job, I have to say.
Jason, that's gay.
Emily did the art, by the way. For the audience.
I am really interested, like, a catastrophe is, like, really my wheelhouse for storytelling. Mm-hmm. Like, as far as the kinds of stories that I feel most comfortable telling, a catastrophe is like if you've seen me run Dungeon World and those sorts of things, you know that's the kind of like where I'm like, and now the town explodes bad.
I mean I love all of them. I especially like as a game writing thing, like I especially love the lists of like things that this can lead to. I think that's really helpful.
Some of the lists in this is just beautiful.
Do you want to read off one of those that you're particularly enthusiastic about so we can all if there's one you like.
A catastrophe does sound very cool, but I think the one that excited me most is a feud. Nice. I like that it says, think of a feud between families, between cities, between noteworthy people, or even between gods. Feuds can lead to social distrust, endemic violence, conspiracy, raiding, robbery, revenge, and the eventual wrath of the gods.
Nice.
Thanks. I kind of like the idea of a feud being a catastrophe, right? Like, like the idea of, well, no, like specifically, like the Bleak House thing, right? Like, like a thing being like that we jump in, you know, 10 years into this like conflict or whatever, and so it's that like the attrition has happened, right? Where at that
point, so you're talking like catastrophe post, a post feud catastrophe,
or like with the feud still going, right?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, like last year of the Trojan War kind of thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's pretty cool. Yeah, I like that. I'm also just like, yeah, I'm super interested in the idea of seeing like a seed of a disagreement just like snowball.
Yeah, that too. I'm that's cool. Also
into that concept of like something very small starting and it just getting worse and worse and worse and worse and worse.
Okay, so well, for some reason my brain pictures this as like a cycle almost. Like you've got the prosperity, which leads to a feud, which eventually leads to catastrophe, and then as they come out, they're prosperous again, which leads to another feud, and it just continues. Is that just history? Does that just happen forever?
That's history. It is, and it's also the cycle that I deliberately wrote into this.
Yep. Nice. That's awesome.
Cheers.
So, on that note, how do you feel about starting with the feud with the expectation that it's going to go straight into catastrophe pretty quickly?
Yeah, I don't mind how, like, I'm happy to see if that happens quickly or slowly.
Because we don't really know.
Yeah, play to find out. I'm happy to start with the feud. That sounds cool.
What's your feeling, Aaron? Do you have a, like,
Feud sounds totally good, and we can also set up some, you know, if there is, like, a be gay part of it, you can always have, like, the star-crossed, you know, people on opposing sides of the feud thing, which is,
definitely.
Classic. Yep.
Mm-hmm. So do we want to place the feud in the world or talk about exactly like who the feud's between and sort of move in that direction?
As far as like feud, I'm interested in like seeing like, you know, two like noble houses both alike in dignity, like
perfect,
Harkonnen and Atreides sort of sort of thing.
Yep A feud between families.
Yeah
A feud between families. And are we thinking like urban city state kind of thing, or in a broader rural region, or like distantly spread across a chain of islands or something like that? Or
I guess when we're like thinking on about how much land and power those families have, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
And my brain was going to the rural setting by default. That was where I was going automatically.
So the question is then, do we want to go with that default, or do we want to reject it specifically because it's our default assumption?
I feel like in this case, I'm actually really excited about that default. I haven't done any campaigns recently in that kind of like Mediterranean rural setting.
Fantastic.
I like the idea of some kind of some sea adjacent places and things like that.
Yeah. So the sort of like coastal rural area, valleys, hillsides.
Yeah,
vineyards, orchards.
Like vineyards and orchards and all those sorts of things for me provide a really good canvas for the imagery of like destruction, right? Like in that we can be like, look how like luscious and prosperous everything is at the start.
And I think too, it makes a really good point of, and I don't know if this is necessarily an inbuilt theme of the game, but it's a theme that I think is really interesting. Like the descriptions in the catastrophe make a point of like things affecting the kind of the people at the bottom. I really love the idea of that, particularly in a feud context. Like, I feel like if we're seeing the kind of the rural landscape and, like, you know, the farmers and the people of the land, we will be able to see sort of the ways in which the rich people fighting affect kind of everyone else.
Society at large, kind of.
Yeah.
And I want to mention something else. Luke in chat is saying, can both families worship the same god in crucially different ways? And I'm saying yes to that. Yes. I'm 100% in favor of that.
See, I'm very so I had kind of an idea about that. Like, it was either that or it might have been like the Romans or something, but there was like house gods where, you know, like...
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like, I figured something like that, and it's like these two families who have... like bunches of plots of land kind of nearby each other, having this war on a bunch of different fronts. And they're all trying to, you know, call their specific god, because obviously their god's the best god, and beat the other one. Yeah. And there's like, where do we put the god, and where does the other one put the god? And
Okay. So what about this? What if one of the families like traces their lineage back to this god, and the other family has some kind of like hereditary high priest position that they pass down from one family member to the next or something like that.
That's
for the same god.
Yeah, that's cool. I like that a lot.
Yeah, that I like it.
That's neat. Yeah.
I'm in my head, the death masks thing from like Roman, I don't know how far back this goes, but like the Roman thing of like having the death masks of all of the patriarchs of the family.
Yeah,
I like the idea of like of that going back to a god.
Yep. Yes, I love it. Yeah, let's definitely have that.
Carrie says, is this one family that split several generations back?
I like the idea that that may be true, but nobody knows it at this point.
It's one of those things that's like, lost to time.
Some know it and it's a secret.
Yeah, there's some point at which like some of the family tree is probably just bullshit, but like even knowing that there's a god at the other end of it, there's like a middle step that maybe we're not so sure about or something like that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I also like Luke's suggestion about someone stole, like to tie into that thing that Aaron was saying about like the household gods and the household idols. Like maybe at some point one was like stolen between like the families. Which would tie nicely into the kind of like, no, you're worshiping that god wrong. We're the true.
Yeah, let's rescue the god, uproot it from your house, bring it to ours. Actually, wait, is that the thing that like really sets off the feud? That one of the gods was uprooted and brought to another place? And it's really interesting that we brought this up, because that's actually a specific thing that the Romans did to a particular Etruscan city.
Oh, wow. Okay.
God and installed that god statue in the Roman Forum.
Wow. Okay. Yep. Okay. So that thing.
Okay, but you used the word uprooted, and now I can't help but think that the god is like a plant.
A literal, like, oh, yeah.
See,
yeah,
I like, thought of the idol as like an installation USB and then just took it and installed it.
Yeah.
God. Aaron, you're home from work. It's okay.
I'm
don't worry.
I'm so sorry. It's in my brain forever.
You just got back.
I like the idea of like a bush or a tree or something that is the like considered to be the embodiment of.
It's like a
tree, maybe a little bit bigger than a person, but like no matter what the weather, it always like survives, and like obviously like, this is a holy tree.
It's kind of like natural bonsai, like it stays this sort of one size, but it's like very, very ancient.
Yeah. Ooh, the god of the vineyard got uprooted, says Luke.
Ooh.
Nice. Yeah, or like the god of the orchard or like
Yes, I have a question in regards to that, which is, I know that I'm like skipping ahead slightly, but I know that there is a thing where we choose a god to focus on.
I was about to bring us into that, so go for it. Yeah,
cool. I was just gonna say, is that would we choose one of these gods to be
that god? Yeah.
That one we can talk about.
Or we can just add a fifth god, and that's totally fine.
I like these gods.
Excuse me.
Very cool.
These are good ones. Are there any that you think overlap with this concept we've had pretty well?
Turenpacha.
Yeah, I was going to say, liberated Turenpacha, bringer of wine, love, ecstasy, sexuality, and revelation.
Okay, which of the...
Our families
do we want to stick with one of the two names or have like one family use one and the other use the other?
Oh, yes.
Ooh, yep.
Yes, definitely that. Definitely.
Okay, great. Let's name these families while we're talking about that, actually.
Okay.
Is there a particular name anyone has in mind for one of them?
Is this something where we could refer to this handy dandy list of Etruscan names that we have?
We can, yeah. So we can put that up on the stream if you want.
I already got it.
And we can, great. We can like pick one off or if anyone wants, just roll a D100 and tell me which list you're picking off of.
Obviously, yes.
That sounds good. All right.
Crap.
Anything jumping out?
I like the idea of using like place names specifically for the families.
We can use place names specifically for the families, or we can just do whatever because it's a dead language and we can do whatever we want.
I got 56 and 71 if those look good.
50.
Okay.
56 in places is Vipina? Vipina?
Vipena?
Vipena?
Mm-hmm. Vipena, Vipena, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, I like that.
71 is amply.
I'm going totally off script. I really like and I'm not sure how I would say it, so I'm gonna guess. Number three from the first list is Talmitha.
That's good.
That's a real good name.
Yeah.
Okay, is that the one who would that be the one who stole or who got stolen from?
Stolen from.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yep, stolen from Talmitha.
Okay, I'm writing down that the Talmitha family worship Turan and their tree idol was stolen by
Nesta, N-E-S-T-U-R.
That's number 56.
That was why I was looking at it, yeah.
Yep, I like it.
Yeah, sounds good.
Who worship Patra? Great. Okay.
Sorry, I really love Usulris of sexuality and revelations. He's a big mood. Yeah, fair.
They're good things to be a god of.
And when we're talking about this countryside, we're not imagining like any particular urban conglomerations or anything. Like each family probably has their own estate somewhere and there are random villages scattered around, but nothing else really.
We're far enough from cities that they don't matter to us.
Yeah. Mm. Or they haven't been found yet and maybe we will someday or whatever.
Mm. Yeah.
Luke is asking which are the descendants and which are the priests if we're sticking with that concept.
I like the idea that Talmitha are the priests and so they were like holding on to the thing and like taking care of it and doing the rites, and then the people were like, no, we're descended from those that motherfucker. We're gonna steal the tree.
Yeah, I like that. That's really good.
Because I think that the Nestors are probably like, they just have it, and then the Talmitha people were like, we're going to use this in our ceremonies. We are priests. This is how you properly worship the god. You idiots, let us show you. And then it got jacked.
Great. Do you feel ready to roll into character creation from here?
Oh, 100%.
Always.
Great.
Is anyone going to be surprised if I want to play like a matriarch?
Nope.
Yeah, but that sounds really good.
Okay, so in Roll 20, we've got some like blank character sheets open. I'm going to get rid of one of them because we're only going to need the three. And you can just put in your name in whichever of them you're claiming, and we'll edit there.
You have to edit it to give us access because.
Oh, I do. You don't have access already. That's annoying.
Yeah. We weren't joined in the campaign when you made it, so it probably didn't give you the option to do that.
Ah, okay. Well, I'll just give one to each of you then.
Yeah. The other thing is, because we're not using we didn't have a specific character sheet for the game because it's like.
Yeah.
Anyway, all 20 stuff. I can edit this one, so I'm going to use this one.
Okay, I'm giving each of you one that you can edit.
Got it.
And
yep.
Yeah, and it. We're not going to use the attributes and abilities section because we don't actually evaluate characters numerically in this game at all. So that's fun. But in the bio and info section, I've just put down a bunch of words, mask, relationships, with how those are laid out, and then spots for two desires.
Okay.
So the first two things we're going to do, aside from like character naming, is we're going to pick their mask once we have a sense of who they're going to be. The mask just represents how they present themselves to the world. It doesn't have to be who they actually are or how they see themselves. What we're doing now is just defining how everyone else in the world is going to see them and interact with them. So it's mostly useful information for everyone else in the game, what you decide your mask is going to be.
Mm. Could you give us like an example of how we might describe that?
Sure, yeah. Like if your character, a mask might be something like, oh, I'm a great war hero from the previous generation, which of course says nothing about like what you actually did during the war. It just means that whenever there's an NPC in the scene, they're going to treat you as if you are a great war hero from the previous generation or something like that. Mm, so like matriarch would be perfect for a mask.
Yeah, I'm just trying to work out whether I'm, whether I'm matriarch of, like, whether I'm, like, Telma's a matriarch or Nesta's matriarch, because they both, because, like, it's really
that's interesting gonna matter.
How different those two characters seem in my head.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Just from that, just from what we know.
Yeah, which is great.
I think Telma the matriarch is the one that's more interesting to me. I think
you're part of the family who has been stolen from.
Yeah, the priest family that had the tree, and then it was stolen by the Nestors.
Yeah, I think that's more interesting. I like the idea.
Yeah, I think if I think playing a Nestor character, the Nestor matriarch I would lean too much into like, I would probably end up playing it as a villain. Which I don't really want. I want to have more complexity than that. So,
yeah, and this brings up some interesting questions that for me, which is like, in general, Jason, do you find that there is like a way that this game works best as far as, or like a space in which this game works best as far as like how central we want our characters to be to like the core like
drama.
I'll put it like this. This game is about what the characters want. 100% of this game is about what the characters want, not necessarily about what they do, but it's going to be extremely tightly centered on what it is they want from the world. The sort of the feud is really in practice just going to be the backdrop and may not even directly impact what the characters are doing depending on what their personal desires are.
It doesn't especially matter so long as we give them strong desires.
So as long as you want something, then the game will have loads of energy and it'll be perfect.
Cool. Yeah, because I feel like I'm leaning toward like being part of more of that, like more of the kind of like farmers outside of the field affected by everything kind of like space, but with some like cool connections.
Two named families.
That seems.
Do you see your character as being affiliated with one side or the other, or are you just? Or like how divided is the society at large? Are there two factions here, or are these very much two families within some broader society?
I feel like at the moment, it's not like I like the idea, sort of like I said before, of like us starting this like not long after this feud has begun, so that like people outside of the families are, and maybe even within the families are still a bit like, oh, how serious is this? Like,
yeah.
Maybe they're just having a bit of a tiff and it'll all blow up.
So we're probably we're probably at the moment where people are really starting to choose sides.
Yeah, I'm really interested in that.
I like the idea. I don't remember if it's the idea that that like the individual farmers don't have a specific allegiance, but rather each harvest or whatever, like there are these families that provide like protection, like go out and just go out to a bunch of the nearby farmers and say, like, do you continue to want our protection?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Pay this fee. And like, so some farmers might pay their protection money to like a different clan each time if they're absolutely, like on the borders of those spaces.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm very much imagining these families as like the proto aristocracy that might think of themselves as something meaningful, but they're still very literally a bunch of rich people with weapons who stab people who don't do what they're told.
I'm thinking what I would love to do is like set up my character as sort of like a well-known kind of I think they're a farmer and they're like fairly sort of they've been doing it a long time and they're fairly like central to the community and they have connections with both families but they are trying very hard to be neutral because I like that becoming increasingly difficult and complicated. Yeah.
I feel like I can see that being one of your desires, like having a neutral position.
Like I think a desire for peace. Like I just want everyone to calm down and things to go back to being all grapes and sunshine.
How do you want other characters to see this character though?
Yeah, I think I want,
like the classic, like a simple farmer.
I think so. I think that's it. I think that is the thing that I push strongest is like that. I'm one of you. I'm just a simple working person. Mm-hmm. And that and like you know wholesome and like, and that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Aaron, what are you thinking about?
So, I was thinking of having like being somebody from the Nestor side of things.
That makes sense, yeah. Because that way we've got representation.
Then we've got, that's awesome.
And I feel like I kind of want her to be somebody in the family that, I feel like every now and then they think that every couple of generations there's somebody who's like, who exemplifies more of like the blood of the god.
Oh, I love this.
And I think he's one of them. Right. But like, I think maybe for her, there's just like this birthmark that's the shape of like a handprint on her breast.
Yeah.
And she tries to, you know, wear stuff to where you can see it. And it's like, yeah, I was touched by the god specifically. Look. So like.
Okay. Yeah, awesome. I like that. How old are you thinking she's going to be? She sounds younger.
I was thinking like early 20s, maybe.
Early 20s, yeah, that makes sense. So the mask, something like touched by the god?
Yeah, I think either that or like divine descendant.
Yeah, that works. That's good as well. So yeah, like the thing the family is known for, but even more so, yeah. Paragon of the family reputation.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah. And from there, we're going straight into relationships. So actually having a name for each character at this point would be good because we're going to want to figure out what everyone's relationship is with each other.
So my character is going to be named Althea Nestor.
Okay.
And I'm Vigoya Talmudha.
Oh, nice.
Okay.
Frozen one yet. Oh, God. They're all so good. Sorry, what are the two first names that we've ended up with for other people?
I picked Althea.
And I'm Vigoya.
Vigoya. Okay, so. I think I'm gonna go with Tyrannus. TYRRHENUS. And I probably have a family name, but it's not super important.
Okay, spell that one more time for me.
TYRRHENUS.
Okay, that's an awesome name.
I'm saying it as Tyrannus. I'm not 100% sure, but that's
the best part about it. We just make shit up as we go.
Yep, cool.
Yep, that language is convenient things about them. So I've got Tyrannus for Emily. I've got Vigoya Tomatha for Ash. And what was the first name for your character, Aaron?
Althea. Althaia.
Althea Nestor. Great. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so relationships. This is going to be an important part. Whoever wants to start can go first, but each one of you is going to have a relationship with the other two.
Okay.
And aside from like talking about like, oh, are we friends? Are we lovers? Are we related distantly or something like that? You're also going to each pick one tag for that relationship. Mm. And there are six tags that you're going to choose from: trust, suspicion, power, competition, intimacy, and violence.
Ooh.
And I do want to qualify that if the relationship ends up having intimacy and violence in it, that doesn't mean intimate violence. That means a whole bunch of different things. Intimacy doesn't necessarily mean sexual intimacy. Violence doesn't mean physical violence necessarily. And there are a lot of different ways that a relationship can be both intimate in some way and violent in some way.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with Mike Rugnetta's definition of violence? I find really useful for this sort of situation, is the removal of of choice or agency.
Mm. Yeah, I like that, and that also bridged pretty well into the power tag, which I want to clarify specifically implies that one of the two people in the relationship has power over the other one in some way.
Gotcha.
So again, not quite the same thing as violence, because like a parent and a child might have power in the relationship, but not violence or something like that. But any thoughts on what relationships you want to have with each other?
Ah, there's so much good stuff in here.
I'm really interested in, and this might, to me, it makes most sense with Emily's character, but this idea of, like, because she's the talent of the matriarch, that she, that like my character often acts as like a vessel for that, like said that revelation, and that in that, like, I think there is probably a thing where she sleeps with people as a part of a semi mystic practice.
Mm-hmm. Oh wow, yeah.
I mean, sexuality is part of the religion thing, so
that was what I was thinking, right? Like, yeah, like,
I mean,
like
that makes sense with that god.
And I was like, is that a relationship that I have with like either of you? It makes most sense for me with Emily's character, but yeah, it could also be.
I'm very interested in that idea, because I was going to say what I think I would like is with the two of you, I would like to have relationships that my character feels very positively about in one way or another, or that are very like close and significant, because I feel like that is the best way for me to be really like, oh no, I just want everyone to, oh God, I care about everybody. So I'm very into that idea.
Yeah, I'm interested in the idea that for Vigoya, like that relationship of sexual revelation is more distant for her than it is for you.
Yeah, that could work.
Because she serves a larger group of people. She serves that role for a larger group of people.
See, it's interesting because I'm realizing as we're talking about it that whilst I really love that that concept, I'm feeling like this character that I'm playing may have like a complex or distant relationship with like sexual intimacy in general. So like, I'm sort of like sitting there and trying to like imagine them and that kind of thing and being like, oh, I don't know, it's a little strange. So I'm really curious about that. And I'm wondering if it could be...
And like, it doesn't have to be sexual intimacy specifically. I think that's one way in which, like, I see it as like Inara from Firefly, mm-hmm. but as a religious vessel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yep. Yeah, I like the idea of it being and we can leave it maybe a little mysterious as to like the specifics of sort of what that involves. But yeah, I like the idea of it being very intimate in the broad sense of the word. And maybe, I think Tyrannus would also engage with it as a religious thing.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's very much how they also see it. But yeah, I think maybe they feel more like, oh, you're choosing to like do this important thing with me, and that's really significant. Whereas, yeah, perhaps to your character, it's like it's just the thing that you do. It's not as sort of special as that or something. I think that's
I like that. Mm-hmm. The other thing I was gonna suggest to Aaron is I like the idea of like asymmetric care between your character and my character, i.e. like my character cares about your character in a way that your character doesn't notice or reciprocate. Right, like because my character's a matriarch specifically, and you are and of this presumably the same figure, she is a priestess of this figure that you are a representative of. She has like some of those like, oh, I have to like look after this person feelings about your character that are probably never even stated.
Yeah.
I don't know. How do you feel about, I don't know what the return of that is. Whether it's like, oh no, fuck you, or like, but that's where I'm like, I like the idea of her having complicated like feelings about like actual family versus like,
chosen,
you know,
family.
Chosen family sort of things, and like family thrust upon you, and
yeah.
Oh my god, wait, are you two the star-crossed lovers, or are the star-crossed lovers like yet to be seen?
I'm on board for that. I was gonna say, like maybe we got introduced to each other by being in the same place when some sort of ordeal went down, and it's like from then on, regardless of whether or not everybody else trusted each other, like you and I had this thing where we trusted each other.
Yeah.
So I'm curious about something. Is this one of those interesting relationships?
Oh no, Jason.
Jason, I'm so curious too.
Yes, an interesting relationship. I hope.
Suspicion.
Okay, you're back. You disappeared for a moment.
Yeah.
Got out of it.
Does that sometimes. Okay. Is this one of those relationships that is characterized by both trust and suspicion?
Oh, yes, I saw mention of that in the... Mm.
I think that power plays a really interesting part in this one.
Yeah, I would think it might be like trust and power. Like you and I have this like willing connection sort of thing, but maybe I'm more of the taker in the relationship, so it's almost like I have power over you.
That's cool.
Yeah, right, like
I feel like that could talk, sorry, I know I don't want to,
no.
I was just gonna say I feel like that could be like two-sided power in that way, because like it may be that being a matriarch gives you like power as far as
I was gonna
like,
say also, with society, great power comes great responsibility. Mm. I think the power you have over me is my responsibility.
Ooh.
Or my sense of it, right?
Ooh, yes.
Right, like I have technically got like power and authority because of being like your senior.
Yeah,
and there's obligation. Yeah,
but then the moment you chose for me to be part of your chosen family, you assumed that you needed to be like
I don't feel like, here's the interesting thing. I don't think feel like I like she's confided in you that she feels this sense of like the sense of like you as like a chosen child.
Mm-hmm. Oh my god. Oh no, wait. You were totally like, maybe your character was like preparing to actually have this conversation when the like the feud began.
Yeah.
Like, I love the idea that like you had developed, like you had developed these really strong feelings and this strong bond, and you were like, okay, like we need to talk about it. And then like everything just kind of
yeah. That's I like fun. The idea that I was like, I was like, oh wait, like this person might actually need to be like inducted into this, you know, specific practice, right? Mm-hmm. And but that never got to happen.
Yeah. Well, both of you should write down this relationship just quickly, a couple notes on it, so that we remember it when we come back after the break and start that scene. And we're not going to go to break immediately, though, because I want to make sure we all have the relationships linked up and then a couple with some NPCs as well.
M, can you put your name in your character so that I can see your...
I haven't saved changes. There we go.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, and also we didn't actually choose our words, Ash. But, so
yeah.
Like intimacy sounds like it's one of them.
Intimacy sounds like one of them.
I want to put something really... I want there to be another complicating aspect. I want to throw something else in there.
It doesn't say in here that these have to be symmetrical, which is what I really... which I'm loving, which is why I was like, I want to set up asymmetric relationships with different people.
Yeah, sweet.
So I like the idea that like your character has like a trust towards my character.
I was going to say, it's not intimacy for me. That's the key. For me, I think the things that we engage in that are intimate are not about intimacy for my character.
They're about religion. In which case, I feel like...
Or trust.
Yeah, trust... I like the idea that it's trust and power then. Like, the power is about is that, like...
Is that the same? Is that what you've got? I don't think it's about power in this case. I think that's not...
Well, from her perspective.
Might be for your character, yeah. I think...
I think from my perspective, it's about... It's like our relationship is about power.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Would you go intimacy and power?
Yeah, intimacy and power.
Okay. I think I would go trust.
I like the idea of it being intimacy, but not in a sexy intimacy way.
Yeah, of course.
So like intimacy and trust as ones for the ones coming at me from you?
No, I'm leaving out intimacy as word. I'm using trust in place of that.
Right.
That's really interesting to me because I think that I want to explore that idea. So I want to choose a second one. I think I'm going to go.
See, no matter what you choose, it makes it more complicated, right?
Exactly. It's great. I'm actually wondering.
I've put Tyrannus, intimacy, power. I'm the vessel of their worship.
Yeah, nice. Cool. I'm tempted to put either suspicion or competition. Ooh. Because if I lent into suspicion, it would be like, it would be that like trust and suspicion kind of interesting combo. Okay. But competition is interesting to me because I wonder if we compete for like respect within the community.
Yeah.
And I think that could be really interesting.
Like who holds the heart of the people?
And like I like that it's asymmetrical because that's a thing that obviously matters to me. Like,
but like it's not even a question to Vigoya.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Cool. Great. Got it. And then Aaron, we need to work.
We do, and I am trying to figure something out.
Let me just write this down and then I can have some thoughts about it. So
Seems like your relationship with Vigoya is more from like a religious aspect and not so much like a commercial aspect.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Okay. Maybe that means you trust the nesters with the kind of protection of your fields.
Yep.
If you're one of the more well-known farmers, it could be you have more people trying to, you know, steal from you. So that could be like a violence aspect of our relationship, is like, I've got people there all the time kind of doing violence to the people who might want to steal from you.
Yeah, I like that. That's really cool.
I like the fact that that means that, like, you're probably more physically distant from Vigoya as well, right? Like, there's almost, like, in order to, like, have that religious experience with Vigoya, you have to almost make a pilgrimage.
Yeah. It's something that doesn't happen often. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I like the idea of that being, like, very sacred and important, but the nesters are part of my daily life.
Mm-hmm.
That's really cool to me. So I like that. I like the idea that your family, like, yeah, protect my lands and the lands of the, like, my neighbors and the people that I care about.
Mm-hmm.
I think violence is a really interesting way to talk about that, because it's not necessarily trust.
Yeah.
But it's like, yeah, we together are often, like, we are involved in violence. Violence happens.
Yeah, violence happens as a direct result of our relationship, sort of.
Mm-hmm.
So I was thinking, maybe since, you know, there's this agreement, you work with us, we work with you, maybe Althea feels comfortable, like, coming to you and having, like, this close friendship where, like, I can't talk to anybody because everybody on my side of the family holds me up on this pedestal because they think I'm the, you know, the reincarnation of this god, basically.
Yep.
So maybe, like, you're my kind of grounding force, where, like, I just come and talk to you. Maybe I'll help you on the farm every now and then.
Yeah.
Like, I'll spread dirt.
I'll just talk to you like a regular person.
Yeah, we talk and, you know, drink tea or whatever, and it's just kind of real chill.
Yep.
Actual person to person friendship, and not like knee bending and stuff.
So interestingly, I would choose intimacy to describe that.
That's fair, because I don't know if that's a trust thing either, because it's kind of like, this is born out of the violent part of the relationship, is why I feel like I can tell you things, because guess what? If you break that confidence, well, we're out and you're screwed.
Yeah.
So
is this one of those intimacy violence things?
Yeah.
Apparently,
yes. Yeah. And I love this as well for me, because I love that, like, that very sort of very close friendship that doesn't have, or at least, like, from what we've talked about, doesn't have, like, sexual intimacy elements, my character says more intimate but less trustworthy than the relationship with Ash's character. And I think that's super complicated. And I
like that.
Yeah, I love it.
Fascinating. Yeah. Cool. Yes.
Okay. So you've all got relationships with each other.
Yep. I just wanted to note the tags for my one with Althea. I have got trust and suspicion. She could have become my daughter.
And I've got trust and power with you, I think, since there's that mismatch.
There's that power gap. Yeah.
Yeah. Also, I think Luke put it real well. It's I'm the figure of your god, basically, but you have more earthly power. So there's, like, two levels of mismatched power.
That's awesome.
Yeah. That's yep.
So great. From here, I want to bridge into talking about NPCs, because the three of you aren't the only people in this community who have relationships with each other. So who else do all of you know who you definitely have a relationship with? I want to propose one first, which is that both Vigoya and Althea clearly have a relationship with Taran and Pacha, respectively.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
And it's clearly a very important relationship for both of them.
Yep.
So I
also very obviously, and I don't know if this came across, there is a patriarch, right? Like
I
have a husband who is technically the head of things. He is the philosopher king, head of the priest house, but Talmud the acts as the mystic lens, mm-hmm. as opposed to the dogmatic lens.
Yeah. So he's the, in the sense that like he's the formal authority.
Yeah.
But you are the one who inhabits the sort of the high priestess role.
Yeah, right, exactly. Yeah. It's that thing of like, he's the one that has to sit at the head of the table during like religious feasts. Mm-hmm. And he's the one that has to perform like all of these specific rituals. Like, Neva has like, you do this on this time. That's never a thing that she does.
He's also the one who's technically responsible for protecting the idol, isn't he?
Yes, obviously.
Yeah. What's his name?
His name is...
We can do it randomly or we can pick one as before. Is it kind of like Tarkon?
Yeah.
Too many T names so far.
Yeah. Malavish.
Yes. Yes, definitely. I will put that one down. And what's your relationship with him like?
It's like, I think it's definitely one where like there's this, like, A, if the tag that jumps out to me is trust.
Yeah.
It's definitely one of like, we kind of move in different circles apart from the fact that we live together, right? That we are husband and wife.
Yeah.
We live very separate lives and like often our conversations are very stately.
Mm-hmm.
Right, like they're very business-like,
and not intimacy, definitely.
No, it's not intimate. That's the thing, right? Like it was once, and then
I feel like there's some subtle competition going on, like not explicitly or anything, but in a kind of passive-aggressive way, starting to.
See, I don't think that, because from my perspective, it's that thing of it's that understanding that like they succeed and fail together.
Yeah. I think you don't think that. I think
he might think that there's a competition because he's a man. Yeah.
that's a very well put.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Sorry, I was writing things. Are we talking about
my husband?
Right. Yeah. Okay.
Who is Malavish?
So yeah. So the thing is, with NPCs, it's the same thing where. Each one of you would choose one of the two tags in the relationship, except you're choosing one and I'm choosing the other. And I am definitely choosing competition for this one.
Yeah, I'll definitely. Yeah.
Can you, yes, that was the bit I missed. Can you describe for me the competition part of the...
So from her perspective, they are two parts of like, because their relationship is quite like business-like and formal these days. They've grown apart. Their intimacy has grown apart. So... From her perspective, they succeed and fail together, right? Like so it's trust is the tag that she has towards him.
And from his perspective, I think he emphatically agrees on the exact wording of that statement, mm-hmm. that they succeed and fail together. He just has a different view of what that means.
Yeah, he probably like thinks that like. Some of the things she's doing are undermining that.
Mm. Yes. Yeah.
Like, yeah.
That like.
I mean, what it is realistically in his head, we succeed and fail together means I succeed or fail on my own. And
100%.
Yeah.
It's 100% that, definitely. Yeah. And we'll get into like working out exactly what the details of that are in play. Does anyone else have a relationship with him, do you think?
Or... I'm wondering if I do.
Yeah.
Because I feel like they're, well, I think it's interesting either way. I think if I don't have a relationship with him at all, that mm-hmm. says something interesting.
Yeah.
But if I do, that's also that's also interesting. Because, is there, does Vergoia have the kind of intimacy with him? Like, does she share sex outside of ritual?
She doesn't have sex with him. Not with him, at least. Mm. I don't know about other situations for that, but she doesn't have sex with him. No. Mm. She had sex with him and she gave him babies. Now we've got babies. Good job.
Done. Yeah.
Our work here is done forever.
Yep. Yeah.
And I think it's known that like sex is part of the ritual stuff with her.
Oh yeah.
It's not like that's hidden.
Well then maybe there isn't. Maybe there is sort of nothing to say. So I can say like if there could be like some tension in that space. But maybe it's more interesting that there just isn't because everyone understands how these things work.
I think this is one of those cases where anything that's going on between them is definitely a private thing, at least at this point. Mm-hmm. And maybe that'll burst out into public later on. But for now, it's not really something that I think the other two of you interact with too much.
Yeah.
Cool. However, Turon or Apacha, or by whatever name we choose to call this god, I think two of you definitely have relationships with him.
I've got Turan listed as intimacy and violence. I think I don't think that she could not be the vessel if she wanted to not be.
Yeah, I see that.
And that is an incredibly intimate thing.
And with Althea, though, because it seems like the two of you would have a relationship as well, Aaron. I feel
Pacha and I. So I feel like it's competition. Because for me, it's one of those, I'm always going to be judged against stuff Pacha has done. If you're a proper vessel, you should be able to do this, 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 and this without any regard to like, you know, my needs, my wants, anything like that. So it's kind of one of those, I have to find space for me and still try to live up to, I mean, I'm in the shadow of a god, basically.
Yeah.
And there is a whole lot of expectations.
I think there's also trust in that relationship, though, because they did specifically choose you to be their, not representative, but they chose to mark you, and they chose to mark you for a particular reason. Mm-hmm. So there is some confidence they have in you, though you probably may not know what exactly that is.
Sounds good to me. I also had another idea.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking of making an NPC that's like the high priest or priest. Okay, so is... Like, are the higher-ranking members of the church on the Talmatha side, are they usually men or women? Can you have both? Is it just...
I think it's probably that, like, it's a masculinely dominated church, but there is always this informal role.
Okay.
That Vergoia currently occupies.
So... Ooh, is it one of those things where like men have all the seats of power, but the chosen every few generations is always a woman?
Potential. I like the idea that the chosen is. I like the idea that it's often a woman or a non-binary person, but not necessarily strict. Like, there's no reason it couldn't be, but it just always happens to be.
Yeah,
or something like that.
I have a feeling that that's the case on the Talmatha side, and on the Nestor side, the sort of presence of the god is always more strongly felt in the women of the family or something like that. That there is very much a different gender structure between these two families going on.
Mm. Mm. Yes.
Does that sound right to everyone, or do you want something else?
Yeah. Well, like my oldest son will be the next high priest of of Turan, my perspective. Mm.
Maybe that's cool. Part of what drove the dogmatic split is kind of the who should take charge and.
Yeah.
Mm. So, yeah, I had an idea for maybe a relationship with the high priest of the Talmatha side. Like,
you mean my husband?
Oh shit, yeah.
Here we go.
Yes.
Okay. This makes me happy.
Awesome. Make it complicated.
Yeah. I have suspicion of him.
Ooh.
Like in mm-hmm. you know, it is always the high priest's mm-hmm. job to, when there is claim that there is, you know, the next vessel of the gods, the high priest's job is to verify that, obviously. So, you know, people aren't bestowing all these gifts to some unworthy kid who just has a weird birthmark. And I think since then, he's always had this weird presence kind of at the periphery. Wherever like troubling times or weird things happen, he always seems to be there, almost as if he's testing me.
Yeah. So I was going to say competition for this, but I think this is a power thing. Because he definitely has, yeah, if it's his role to verify that you are who you claim to be, then there's a huge power relationship here. And mm-hmm. he declares that you're fake or false or untrue in some way.
Yeah, and I feel like I can't mention the fact that he skeeves me out. Because if I do, it's one of those things where it's like, you know, this person is your boss, so if you report them for shitty behavior, they can retaliate against you, kind of thing.
Exactly, yeah.
It could even be, it sounds like it could even be suspicion on both sides. Like, maybe there is some reason why he's being so, vigilant.
I'm putting down suspicion and power as well.
Okay.
Which brings us to Emily, because we're looking for two NPC relationships from you as well.
So I think I don't want to give my character a specific relationship with Turan or Pacha. Mm-hmm. I think I have a great respect for that god. That's why I engage in the ritual, and obviously
you don't have a relationship with that god. You engage in that relationship through.
Yes, exactly, through you. Yeah. And I think, like, it's interesting because I noticed a thing that I'm going to have to try not to get tripped up by, but I kind of want to bring it into the narrative, where I was like, I've realized that I've chosen a name that is very similar to Turan, and I think that is a thing. I think I was named after.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think it's, like, always been a part of my life, but I think the god that I most deeply have a connection with is actually Katha/Suri, because it mentions here that is the god who causes the crops to grow. So I think, like, yeah, I think I have several gods that I worship for different reasons, but that is the one that, like, that I have a personal connection to.
Is there a name that you prefer for them between the two?
Let's go Suri.
Okay, great. And you have a personal relationship with them.
Yeah, and I think I would choose trust, definitely. I think, like, I have maybe a bit of a blind trust in God, because they have a lot of quite other, like, deep and dark qualities. But, like, as far as I'm concerned, you know, they make the land work, and that is the most important thing. And I'm sure they always have my best interests at heart, you know, and everyone's. So I think trust is definitely one of them.
Yeah, I see this as a trust power thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally.
Especially with it being blind trust.
Yep. Yeah, exactly. Yes, I trust them, and I'm very, like, I obey them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And one more relationship?
Yeah, I kind of want to maybe throw in another totally new NPC, because we don't have a whole lot.
I like it. It's lovely.
Could it maybe be somebody who runs the market?
Yes, that could be really cool.
Ooh, nice. Yeah.
That sounds good.
I liked the thing that Luke and I were talking about in chat, with the idea of, like, we're still in the early enough period where there's a market day, but you don't have to have a town for it.
Yeah,
yeah, like, yeah, you just set up.
Everyone meets up, and, like, and there are merchants, right, that go around different market days. So, because that's the where our 7-day week comes from is market days in different towns, because they would have like a a 6-7-8 day like circuit.
That's pretty cool.
So I think that I think the person who runs the market, can I give them a name and pronouns, or is that a thing that
go for it?
Okay. I think this person's name is Tiv, T-I-V.
Yep.
And I think she has she, her pronouns. And I think she is like a really like fiery person. She's like a doer. She gets shit done. And I think she also has a very strong connection with the Talmudah family, and like I think that's where she and I have some, like, there is some tension, because she believes that they should be doing for us what like the Nesters are doing for us, like that their protection is maybe better, or like I don't know, she's getting invested in the feud in ways that are uncomfortable for me. I think
do you see some violence emerging in this relationship?
I reckon that is definitely a part of it.
But I feel like there may also be intimacy here.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that could be really good.
In a similar sense that you have with... No, was it trust with Althea, or was it intimacy?
No, it's intimacy with Althea. Yeah.
Intimacy with Althea, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, in that same sort of way, I feel like.
Yeah, yeah. I wonder if maybe... this person is could be related to me. Like Tiv might be like my sister or my cousin, or like someone that I've known for a really long time.
Ooh, maybe it's somebody you're related to through marriage.
Oh yeah.
So there's not that blood closeness, you know, necessarily.
Oh, I was gonna say I haven't given myself a spouse or anything, but I think that I had a spouse, but my spouse is no longer alive.
I think your spouse was her sister or brother.
That works. I think that's really she's good. My sister-in-law. Tiv is my sister-in-law, but my wife, her sister, is dead. Yeah.
RIP.
And. Okay, and from there, I think we should do desires and then just go to break, because we're running a little bit long right now.
Okay, sounds good.
So,
I for Tiran, I listed it as intimacy, violence. I cannot deny their embodied revelation.
Oof, that is good.
Wow,
that's nice and sharp. Mine are a little long, but my descriptions are for Vergoia. I have trust, competition. Vergoia engages in intimate rituals with me. I am vulnerable in this space, and I trust her as a representative of our shared God. I do not necessarily trust her to know what is best for the community.
Nice.
And one quick question for Tyrannus. What was your wife's name?
I think her name was Priestess.
Priestess. Perfect.
So are we reading out our summary of NPC relationships?
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. So I've got the one with Pacha. It's the trust competition. It says, I was specifically marked by Pacha for a reason, so they must have confidence in me. What's the pronouns for the gods?
Anything for all of them. All gods have multiple genders.
Okay,
yeah,
cool.
I like the idea that it depends on the version of them that you engage with.
I feel like I have to live up to a lot of expectations to even be visible in Pacha's shadow, and it weighs on me heavily. And then with Malavish, I had the suspicion power. Malavish is always floating in the periphery and seems to be at the root of many of the problems in my life. I also feel like he's trying to use me and doesn't trust that I am who I claim to be.
Great. And with that, I think we should go to break now and then do the desires quickly when we come back, if that sounds good to everybody.
Yeah, that sounds good.
Sounds good.
Great.
Sounds good.
All right, let me bring us to... we will be right back, everybody. And then we're back.
Great.
Yeah.
Hello again, everyone. We're gonna finish up the characters by doing two desires for each of them, and then we're gonna roll straight into doing scenes and show off what the game looks like during actual play. Uh-huh. And we'll probably wrap up pretty fairly quickly after a few of those, because they tend to go pretty fast. So desires, does anyone feel like they know what their character's desires are going to be? Keeping in mind that these are like the things that the game is going to be about. Actually, I should talk about that just a little bit.
Sure, go for it.
You're going to, as players, all of you are going to play to see if and how you achieve your character's desires and what consequences come from accomplishing them. We're going to do two each, and we're going to do them based on the world, the relationships, and other players' characters for inspiration. And if your desires seem completely contradictory to each other, that's great. This isn't Burning Wheel. We're not trying to actually use the desires to get anything. They're just the things the game is going to be about in general. Also, when you say that your character has a desire, you're also saying that your character does not have that thing, and that you expect that it's going to be difficult for them to get it. And my role as High Priestess is going to be to make it difficult for the character to get that thing.
So I think I definitely want to go with one that is about like a desire for like peace and quiet and for everyone to get along. I'm just not quite sure how to like word that, and I need it to be something specific to me.
I've got one which is harmony under House Talmother.
Nice.
Specifically.
Yeah, yes. Wow. I think okay. Yeah, whereas like I want
so the interesting with the like peace and comedy desire is that if you say, oh, my character desires peace and everyone getting along, then by definition, as soon as the game starts, there is no peace.
Yeah.
is this where you want to go with that?
Hey, we may need to go to be right back for a second. For some reason, the Roll 20 capture crashed and it's not on the overlay.
Sure.
Okay.
Sorry.
We will be right back.
Hello, everybody. I apologize for those technical gubbins. Occasionally, technology spiders get into my computer and they start just spinning electro webs, and it's a whole nightmare. I've gotten the vacuum cleaner.
That does sound like a nightmare.
They are put away. Louisiana is wild, y'all. Please continue, Jason.
Okay. I don't remember exactly whose desire. We were talking with Emily, I think, about one of yours.
Yeah, and the question was whether, like, if I if I make my desire about like peace and quiet and everyone getting along, then that like by definition means that I don't have that currently. And I think I'm good with that. Like, I like the idea that at least at this point in time, that could take the form of like people constantly coming to my house to have opinions about the feud and try to get me to have opinions about the feud and like problems with security and problems with like getting my work done and lots of interpersonal just like stress. And I think that's a thing I'm really like interested in.
Is there a way we can frame this more positively and not just like
not for the problem to go away? Yeah, gotcha. Like maybe it would be a thing that I would want anyway.
Because whatever it is that you want, clearly this is all complicating it.
Yeah. Okay. Ooh, let me think on that for a minute. Can you come back to me?
Let's jump back to Ash because we actually no. Let Aaron. Do
yeah,
you have
I, any? I've got my two. I think I've got Harmony under House Talmiver.
Yep.
And an understanding of the gods.
Nice.
That's pretty good.
Which means you just don't have that.
Yeah.
Perfect.
I engage in ritual. I engage in embodiment, but like her whole thing is mysticism. It's about not knowing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let's see. Okay, so I've got one. It's a desire to be seen as the true embodiment of Pacha and accorded the respect that is due to me because of it.
Okay, which means that you're not being seen that way now.
Yeah, I think until Malavish gives like a... I think maybe he gave like an initial like tentative sort of decree, like... We still have to see, but there's a possibility, and it's kind of fuck things up a little bit. So, like, people in my side of the family, people on my side of the family are okay with it.
He's deliberately withholding recognition as part of the feud, isn't he?
I think that might have been part of what started it.
That's amazing. That's really good, actually.
And do you have another desire, or are you still thinking about
I'm still
one?
Trying to word it, but I think Althea wants to find somebody that she can, like, love and trust and kind of put her everything into. Somebody who loves her for her, not because of how she was born.
Perfect. Yeah. So to be loved by someone... as herself rather than because of her connection with the god.
Yes.
I think I'm gonna say that mine takes more the form of like my character has this like vision of this kind of like peaceful like pastoral Eden.
Yeah.
Maybe they didn't have growing up and like always yearned for. And so like that is their kind of life's purpose is to like create this sort of like unrealistically idyllic place. I think it's a very kind of a naive idea, but yeah, I think that's does that give it more of a like
I like it.
Positive thing? Okay. Mm-hmm.
And is there another one, or are you still thinking about that?
I'm still thinking about it, but I wanna make it really pointy because I feel like that one is very kind of like
Yeah.
And I want something that I can really like, and like it's still quite defensive, right? As I want something.
Yeah. You were saying something earlier about how your wife had died.
Yeah.
And with this god now.
Yeah, I thought about that because I the god that I worship in regards to the land is also associated with the dead, and I did have the thought of like, does my character like want to see their wife again? And that could be a thing. I think if it were going to be that, I would just go with like they want to see their wife one more time. Mm-hmm. I don't think I would go with like they want their wife back, because I think that that would lean into like spaces that I'm actually not comfortable like going to.
Yeah, yeah. A bit too what's it called, Full Metal Alchemist.
Yeah, exactly. I don't think we want to go down that route. I don't know. I'm not sure that that's necessarily. I don't know if I'm invested enough in that for it to be like a core thing.
Whether you want the game to be about that.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. It's tricky.
What about something connected to Tiv in some other way?
Mm-hmm. Yes, that could be good. Well, maybe I do just need to lean into that and like see where it goes. Cause it is, I think anything else that I would introduce, would be, like that's different enough to the other one.
Yeah.
I think, let's go with like, I think it's not specifically like, I just want to see her again. I think there's like something I need to ask her.
Yeah.
Like there was an unresolved question or, something that I like can't move past. Mm-hmm. And so, there's this really intense desire to just have a talk with my wife and like have closure.
Yeah. And we can like figure what out exactly.
Yeah, I'm happy that to be mysterious at the moment. So, mm-hmm. Yep, cool.
It's the theme of the game too.
Yeah.
So with that, we'll be ready to go straight into the first scene pretty soon. If you want, as well, before we do that, Aaron, you could show off. Can you see the two handouts, the NPCs and the world thing?
I do.
On roll 20. Okay. On the NPC one, I've just made some quick notes for the different NPCs and for a couple different groups. And it's not really important whether players do or don't know this. So we can just show for the audience that I've given every NPC a particular motivation tag. Mm-hmm. There's six of these, and they're all going to sort of indicate the ways in which the NPCs are going to act in general. And then for the groups, they all have a type that describes the way they act in concert. So for NPCs, it's what they want. For groups, it's how they act as sort of a gestalt or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Again, really cool.
I just wanted to show you all that because I think it's cool, and we can talk more about that after the game because it hasn't really been a part of the conversation so far. And from there, let's go to a scene, I think.
Also, these handouts have real good art.
Oh, yeah. That's amazing. Like, whoever did that did a fantastic job. It's one of my favorite things about
like
this game.
Looks like fun art to make.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Let's do a scene. So the way scenes work in this game is that every scene is started by a specific player, and we think about that player as kind of like a scene leader. So even if there are other characters in that scene, we're still going to, for the most part, be focused on what that one player is trying to get out of it. So who wants to start things off?
I'm trying to see.
It's not necessarily, I'm not necessarily putting my hand up, but I guess I would be interested in being part of a scene of one of the others wherein like my farm is the setting.
Mm-hmm.
But the conflict that is happening or the tension.
So whatever's happening, it's happening at Taranis's farm then. Mm. And we know that like the last thing that happened was somehow, or people have heard like the gossip and the rumors, and some of you have like personally seen that the idol, the tree of Turan, has been uprooted and stolen from the house of Talmitha? How do we pronounce it again?
Talmitha.
The house of Talmitha, and has been replaced in the house of Nestor. That's the most important thing that's happened so far. What is your character, whoever's going next, what is your character doing after that?
I could be there to have one of my regular visits.
Maybe you're with Tyrannus. Yeah, you could be telling me about what's happened, or.
Yeah, I think probably I'm there for our normal, you know, chat session where I think Althea brings like a spare change of clothes in a bag so that she can put on clothes to help out around the farm, because I think if she was seen leaving Nestor property dressed like that, they would think really weird things about her and, you know, family, social standing, etc. So yeah, I think she came over, she changed, and she's helping out on the farm, and I think she might be asking you questions about Precis, because she's kind of got love and yearning kind of stuff on the brain. Like,
wow,
she's been given much in life, but you had a thing that she deeply wants. And I think she's also there to break the news that we're going to have to pull some of our protection back, because some stuff went down and we need to keep the house fully protected.
So do you break the news first, or do you ask the question first? Because I really want to hear what this question is that you're asking.
I think she starts it, and she you know, there she's spreading some dirt or whatever the task of the day is, and she's like, I guess I have some information for you, and I also have a question.
Of course.
Which would you like first?
Also, I'm really curious to know what you look like, because for me, I'm a very visual player, and I like to be able to imagine lovely scenes in my mind. So I'm really curious if you would be able to share like a sort of a description of like, yeah, what do you look like at this time?
Yeah. So I think she's, I mean, probably mid 5 foot something range, like, you know, 5'6", 5'7". She's got longish like black hair, these bright green eyes. Right now she's wearing kind of raggedy clothes, but usually she dresses very nicely in kind of light, almost kind of pastel colors or jewel tones or something. And she always dresses to where you can see at least part of that birthmark on her chest.
Cool. And I think for me, I think Tyrannus is like quite tall and sort of stocky, broad and stocky. And I think they're like always wearing like farming clothes. They're always muddy. They're always dusty, like just perpetually, even if they've just washed. And I think they have like sort of quite dark curls, like a big sort of big mane of dark curls. And I think they're probably like maybe around like in their mid-50s thereabouts. So they're like, yeah, I think they've got like a little bit of like salt and pepper happening like in their hair. And yeah, maybe we're working together like in an orchard or something, I think, today. Picking or pruning or something. Can you say to me again, like, what was the?
Yeah. So I've come today, and I've got a question, right, and an information. Which do you want first?
I think I say, I think I say to you, which one is weighing heaviest on you?
The question, I suppose.
Then I'd like to hear that first.
Okay. I just want you to know that if you choose not to answer it, it won't affect, you know, business dealings or anything like that. I would never do that to you. That's not fair. But how did you know your wife was the one?
Oof. Yeah, so I think there's like absolutely like a pause. They kind of like stop what they're doing for a second and sort of like don't immediately look at you. And then just like continue the gesture, mm-hmm. What they were doing. And they still kind of don't quite make eye contact.
Yeah.
And I think they say, I'm not sure I ever felt that way. Like there was one and I'd found her, but I suppose I knew I wanted to share my life with her, mm-hmm. when I saw how she loved the land, and I knew that that was a thing that we could share and that we could nurture in one another. Mm-hmm.
So it was a sort of a shared interest that brought you together?
And they kind of smile like it seems like the sort of the biggest understatement, but basically, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
and yeah, so they sort of like smile a little bit and they say, yes, I think it's important that those close to you help you grow.
Hmm.
And then I think they kind of like look, like give you a bit of a like side eye and say, this is something you're thinking about a lot.
I want to jump in here.
Yeah.
Mm.
It sounds to me like Tyrannus is offering Althea a gift.
Ooh. Ooh, mechanics, yay.
Okay, so we're going to, cool. For the first time, introduce the offer a gift mechanics. When a character acts for someone they have a relationship with without seeking a particular outcome, they offer a gift. For this act to count as a gift, it must be something the character sincerely believes the recipient wants, and the character must expect nothing in return. Uh-huh. Offering the gift must fulfill its own purpose. And this sounds like...
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yep, that fits with my intent. Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Great. So the way offering a gift works is that happens.
Great.
Now, whether the recipient is a character or NPC, they have to accept the gift if they believe it's sincere and it's something that they're willing to accept in the first place. And they must then immediately offer a gift in return, unless the relationship with the giver is characterized by power or violence. So at this point, Althea must offer a gift of some kind back to Tyrannus.
Although
we do have violence.
You do have violence in the relationship, so you don't actually have to. That's true. So does the violence in the relationship prevent you from doing that, or is there a gift anyway? It's entirely up to you.
I think there's a gift anyway. Mm-hmm. I think seeing you willing to, you know, open up and share these very private things and talk with me about it, I think she's going to figure out a way to make sure that you don't lose any protection people.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that would be her gift, is not leaving you shorthanded.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's presumably something that are you going to tell her that now, or is this just going to be something that you do by yourself behind the scenes?
I think when it comes
behind the scenes from their perspective.
Yeah, I think when it comes time to give the information part, I think she'll probably hint at it. Not you know, hey, because you were nice to me, but it's going to be like, we were worried that we wouldn't have enough forces to defend the house and help protect your farm, but mm-hmm. I'll see to it that something is done to where you are not in any danger.
So my question then is, do you change the topic of the conversation to that now? Or
yeah, do you answer the question about like why you're thinking about these kinds of things, or do you just sort of like deflect by being like, the other news I needed to tell you?
I think she does do that while she tries to figure out how to talk about the fact that she's been thinking about relationships a whole lot, and kind of the fact mm-hmm. that she's not particularly expected to have one given the duties of her position and such.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. So how do you describe the event that has happened? Because I think that's very telling.
Mm. So I think she says, well, there's been a bit of an incident between the Talmuthas and my family. It's something I don't agree with, and I feel like this will cause much more harm than it does good. I feel that tensions will be higher between the families and everybody between them as a result. Initially, I came here to tell you that we were worried that we wouldn't have enough people to spare to give you the full protection force that we normally do. But given our long and prosperous working relationship, I'll see to it that you do not have to go without because of actions that you had no part in.
I think they like, assuming this is a thing that like is okay within our relationship, I think they put a hand on your shoulder.
Mm-hmm.
And sort of like nod and say, thank you. I really appreciate that. That means a lot. I have heard some murmurs, but I wasn't really sure of the details. Something was stolen.
It's an idol. The what did we call it?
The tree of Turan is what I called it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
or Turan's tree or something like that. But you would call them Pacha, I guess.
Pacha's tree. They uprooted it and they took it.
Oh. And I think there's like an awkward pause because, of course, so it's going to take me a little while to get used to which way around the families go. But of course, because it's your family that has taken taken the tree. Yeah. So I think there's a bit of an awkward pause where like I feel slightly uncomfortable about having described this as something being stolen.
Yeah. I think she probably notices that, and I think she puts a hand on your shoulder and she says, what is said between us is between friends. Don't worry that I will judge you or think poorly of you for the way that you describe the things that you've heard and the things that you feel.
They sort of like they look a little relieved and they say, I don't know what goes on between religious folk. I know that the rituals are very important, but I wouldn't presume to understand how and why. I hope that this will be resolved. And if there's anything I can do to help that process go smoothly and quickly, I would very much like to.
I may have to take you up on that. If it proved necessary, would you be willing to perhaps let us use your land as a neutral territory to discuss things?
They kind of like take a deep breath and they sigh and they say, yes, of course, there can be wine for all, and I'm sure that will smooth things out. Yes, absolutely.
I have a quick question here.
Yeah.
Do you feel like you trust them with that, or do you want them to make an oath that they will do this?
Mm-hmm. I would be keen to make an oath.
You can make an oath if you want.
Yeah. I think I would like to, because I like the mechanics described by oath.
Fantastic.
So
okay.
Where are there we go. Yeah, I have to find them again now.
Page 10 at the bottom.
Yep. Cool. Page 10. All right. There we go. Yep. Any statement that includes the words "I swear" is an oath. Yeah. So I say that, and then I say, for you, my dear friend, I swear I will do this. I'm sure we can, I'm sure it will all go fine.
Fantastic.
I hope so. And thank you again, truly.
I think that's a great place to cut off the scene, if that's okay.
Absolutely.
Sounds good.
Great. I'm going to write down that oath quickly.
Yep.
And
I should,
curious what Ash is up to. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Go ahead, Emily.
No, I was just going to say I'm going to make note of the oath as well. Yeah. So I remember I said that.
I'm just trying to work out, like, because I think I would be speaking to someone in the Nesta family. I'm not sure that it's Althea, though. I think it's, like, someone... someone like kind of senior in the Nesta family, and like it's 100% the like peace talks pre, like as things are falling apart and being like, you know,
trying to keep them from getting worse.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it's that thing of like whoever she's speaking to is, it's definitely that thing of like, we have held and tended the Tree of Turand for generations. To see it so horribly uprooted has caused great grief within our house. We beseech you that you return it to us, that we may continue to practice our proper practices.
And where are you? So you're speaking to.
I feel like this is at night, right? This is probably clandestine almost.
Yeah, somewhere in private, some representative of the House of Nestor has come to speak with you. Is this just at Tyrannus's farm the same day or something?
No, I don't think it's Tyrannus's farm, but it's in some. I think it's probably on
the marketplace, maybe.
Yeah, I like that idea. The meeting place, you know.
Yeah, I think
there is no market there now. It's just the meeting roads.
I want to give this person a name.
Yeah,
I'm not sure what name. If you have any preference for that,
not specifically, but I can choose you one.
Okay, if you can just do like a D100 on it.
Yeah, let's do that. Okay, 55 is Ariel.
Ariel, okay.
She's you know, putting this plea to them.
Yeah, they are somewhat younger than how old is Vagoya again?
50s.
50s. Yeah, I think they're somewhat younger than you. Not young necessarily, but somewhere in the 40s range. They've got fairly. They're not well dressed right now. They're sort of doing the cloak over.
Oh yeah.
Pulled up over
head. And I'm the same. You know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. And they say back to you, this is completely out of the question. The Pasha's tree is our birthright as her descendants. And it's a crime that it was ever in the house of Tamatha to begin with.
She says, I hope to speak to you because I hope that you would see sense that this has happened clandestinely and by force. It will surely cause war between our houses. We have this opportunity now to put this right. These things have put things back to as they have been for generations.
Is there something in particular you're looking for out of this conversation?
I want this person to go back to their house and try and convince people to give, like, I want them to try and do convincing. I don't, like, I'm not sure that they're going to, but, like, I want there to be question in about whether or not it's the right thing to have it in the first place.
Great.
In House Nesta.
I think this is a great time to start a contest, which is
that
the
sounds other like a good idea for me.
Resolving things. Mm-hmm. The way a contest starts when one player says they want something in particular. So you contrast this with offer a gift, which is when you, by definition, don't have a particular outcome that you have in mind.
Yeah.
And I'm just going to take us through this step by step because I feel like it's simplest that way. Mm-hmm. We know what your intention is for this. So let's go to the, let's just do the first roll of the contest where you will roll a d8 and I'll roll a d6. And that's a 1 for me. So right now your total is 4, my total is 1 because you rolled a 4 and I rolled a 1.
Yep.
And in contests, whoever rolled lower takes the first turn. And then we just go back and forth, and on each turn you can choose to either resolve and end the contest with one side or the other winning or losing, uh-huh. or you can persist if you're a player and complicate if you're a GM or a high priestess. So I am going to complicate. And So how complications work is I will roll a certain number of dice, and the number of dice I roll is going to depend on the number of specific, distinct complications that I threaten or execute on. And right now, there doesn't really seem to be anything that's on the table that I can execute, so I'm going to come up with something to threaten. And I think... Yeah, Aurel crosses their arms and sort of leans back and says to you, how could I respect myself if I came to my family and asked them to undo what they had just done, like a collective decision? We must all go along with the will of our families. The whole must be more important than the will of the individual.
Then why are you here?
Why
would you come and speak to me if you had not at least some doubt as to whether or not this action would bring ruin upon your family?
You deserve to hear why we did it. And that takes us to 4, which is a tie, which means that it passes over to your turn, and it is now your choice of whether to resolve, in which case you would get what you want, and there would be another complication, or you can persist again, roll another die, and I would add a die to the High Priestess pool, which we're imagining exists. It started with 4 dice in it. It's down to 3 right now. And that's just sort of the number of complications that I can pull out and use during a contest. It's a little tricky to make work on Roll20, but when you have physical dice in front of you, it's a lot more intuitive.
All right, so I think...
And I do want to clarify that you can just resolve here, and you will get the thing that you want, but I'll get a free complication.
I think I like the idea of a free complication on your part.
Okay.
So yeah, I'm going to resolve.
Okay. Aral, yeah, and the thing you said, though, what was the last thing you said?
I think the last thing I said was like you wouldn't be here if you didn't think that I think I'm going to go with you wouldn't be there if you didn't think there was some sin in what has happened.
And Aral pauses and doesn't say anything for, I think, a fairly long moment. And then says, I will carry your words back to my family, but you will not receive the tree.
And I think she just says, carry your words back to the carry my words to your family, and then she turns around and and makes her way.
Yeah, that's a pretty fast end to that scene, I think.
Yeah.
So we can roll straight around back to Emily now. Actually, you know what? I want to do a quick check-in at this point. I forgot to do it before the previous scene, but I'm trying to get more in the habit of doing this, which is just like whenever a scene ends, people who are involved in it, like, hey, how did that scene go? Are we good? Do you want to?
Yeah, I liked that. I liked that, the smallness of that scene.
Yeah,
It felt very intimate.
I feel like I want there to be a clearer relationship between you and Aral after this, but we can figure that out.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. All right. What is a scene that I would like to make happen? I think after I have had this conversation with Althea. I have a desire to hear like the other side of this. So I think, I guess, Ash, question for you, like, do we have a relationship where I could like ask to like speak with you or come and see you, or would I need to go, I'd need to go straight to, like, would I be more likely, would it be more formal for me to speak with you or your husband?
You would seek an audience with my husband. You would speak to me kind of like as a part of our time together.
So I would go to you if it were like specific to the rituals that we engage in.
Yeah.
Or no, really, I wouldn't go to you, would I? You would come to me.
Mm.
Like, that's the impression that I get. It's like, I don't really seek you out. It's just when you decide it is the time to do a religious something.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, because that's. That's the opposite of the way that I had it around in my head. But
oh, interesting. Okay, tell me more about, like, how you...
I get that. The idea that, like people would come to... when they're feeling lost or confused or scared.
Interesting. I think if that were the case, then we wouldn't have a relationship,
right? Okay,
that's not how I interact with that god.
Well, in that case, Perhaps I come and visit you then.
Yeah, but like, yes, sorry. So I'm asking
as an option for the scene.
No, I think I like the idea that I like the idea of going and having an audience with
Malavish.
Yeah, what's his name? Sorry,
Malavish.
Yeah, because I think I have thought about this and decided that this is even if you are a person to seek out when it comes to like worries, I think this is. That this is crossing.
This is political, not a thing that you're worried about for yourself more.
Even though it's related to religion, I think that I would be worried about mixing the two.
Yeah.
So I think
we can probably just jump, like, not have the whole, I go up to the door and I knock and I wait for the person. Let's just jump straight to when the two of you are in the room together, which is probably, you've probably been waiting for him for a bit.
Yeah.
In the hall that's usually a dining room,
mm-hmm.
I feel like. Mm-hmm. And after I don't even know how long, he finally comes down the stairs, walks in, just remarkably casually sort of nods to you, mm-hmm. pulls out a chair and sits himself down in it. And he's, I think he's about 60, fairly strongly built, but also fairly thickly built. Mm-hmm. Short cropped hair, very short beard. Everything's very well ordered about him, except for the fact that it seems like he hasn't slept a wink. Mm. Just deep circles under his eyes.
Mm.
He mm-hmm. nods to you and gestures for you to speak.
I push down my instinct to like kind of, you know, my instinct to care, to be like, oh, you look like you're having a hard time, because we don't have that kind of relationship. I say, I'm very grateful that you would meet with me. I imagine it has been a very busy and difficult few days.
He just sort of like leans back and bursts into laughter.
Yeah, I kind of like, I'm a bit like surprised when he does that.
And he doesn't apologize for surprising you.
Yeah, right. That's great. There's sort of this like kind of pause, and then I say, of course I'm here about the incident. I imagine many people have come to ask questions or offer help. I just wanted to know what had happened. And I think like as they're talking, they're getting like a little uncomfortable, because they're realizing like they've just sort of come here it seems a bit like they've just come here to be nosy.
Yeah. Like, oh, there's this tragedy that happened to you. Can you tell me something?
Tell me all about it. Yeah. So they're getting a little like uncomfortable.
Is there something that you're looking for out of this conversation?
Yes. I think I am specifically looking for information that will help smooth things over. So I want to find out something that can then be like actively used in like peace talks.
Great. Let's do this as a contest as well, mm-hmm. and just roll straight into it in the same way that we did Thash. So.
All right. So yes, I'm still trying to grasp this, but if you could talk me through,
so, it, that would be great. Normally, when I'm doing a complication, I remove a die from the High Priestess pool for that. But the first roll is always free for both of us, which means you're going to roll a d8 and I'm going to roll a d6.
Okay, cool. All right. I roll a d8. Okay.
I rolled a 1 again.
Ah, yikes. Okay. Okay, I got a 4.
Another 4.
Another 4. Okay. Mm. I'm starting to wonder if there's something up with these guys. But in any case, it's my turn, so I'm going to complicate.
Mm-hmm.
And he leans forward and looks you in the eyes and says, you've come to spy for the Nestors, haven't you?
Oh, God.
I ought to throw you out of here immediately.
Wow.
And that's two complications. That's one, that he thinks you're already on their side, that he will come to think that you're already on their side, and two, that you'll be thrown out immediately. So I'm going to roll 2d6 plus 1 for a level.
Yep, sure.
Not a whole lot, but okay.
Okay.
So it passes over to you, and it's now your turn to decide what to do. You can resolve and not get what you want.
Mm-hmm.
You can
because persist. I'm currently my overall, just to make sure I understand this right, my overall number is lower.
You're at four. I'm at six right now.
You're at six.
So you would lose.
Yep. Gotcha.
Or you can persist, which puts a die into the High Priestess pool, taking it from one to two, giving me more complications to use during the contest.
Gotcha. Yeah.
And but then you get to roll another d8.
Yeah.
So
okay.
In the long run, it'll go in your favor.
Sure. Okay.
Or,
yes.
Mm-hmm. Or you could make another oath to a different god to have them directly intervene in this contest, make things go your way. But now you're at two oaths and it's the first session.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's
totally fine. Totally fine.
Sounds great. Mm-hmm. I'm going to hold on to that one as an option, but I think I'm going to try and persist.
Great.
And so I think what that looks like is that, I immediately like put both hands up and I say, no, please believe me. I would never, I have always been just a simple person of the land. I just want what's best for the community. I want peace and neutrality. And on that, I would like to offer my farm as a place to have difficult discussion. I want there to be openness between all people, and of course I care very much about this sacred idol.
Roll your d8 plus four.
Okay. 1d8. So I run 1d8 plus four. Cool.
Nine. Okay. Yeah, I'm going to resolve on this because I don't think there's any fair way to execute either of those complications that I introduced.
Sure. Okay.
So he sort of breathes heavily from this shouting at you and gesturing that he's just done. Mm-hmm. And says, Vigoya's visited you, hasn't she?
And is he's talking about Ash's character?
Yeah.
That's a good question. When he says this, does he mean like recently, or does he mean in general?
He means recently.
I guess that's a question. Has Vigoya visited me recently? Okay, Ash is shaking her head. Yeah, I feel like the answer is no, but it's a very interesting question because like it has me wondering what he wants the answer to be.
Mm-hmm.
I think I kind of hesitate and I say, and just to clarify, we decided that like the involvement that Vigoya and I have that is like in intimate ritual is like a known thing. Like I imagine this is a thing everyone knows about.
It's
like
that. Completely so, above board. Yeah.
Cool. So I think I say, I pause and then I say, not for a little while. And then I just kind of like wait, like to see what his reaction is to be like, is that what you wanted to hear or not what you wanted to hear?
Yeah, he keeps eye contact with you and sort of, it's one of those moments where he's clearly trying to figure out what's going on behind your face.
Mm-hmm.
And it's clear that there's something that he's looking for, but you have no idea what it is at this point, or at least not until this point have any idea what it is. Yeah. But finally, he just sort of leans back again and sighs and nods and says, yes, I suppose it would be useful to have a place to talk to the bastards.
Yep. Okay. Good. Yeah.
And I think that ends that scene.
Yeah. Yeah. That's great. That's awesome.
Yeah. How do you feel about that one?
Really good.
Great. He's
so aggressive. I love it.
Yeah. He's fun.
Yeah.
I like him in a horrible, horrible way.
Yeah. Same.
Yeah. So we're pushing up on 2.5 hours.
Yeah.
I think if we feel good ending here, that's about the spot to end the session.
That seems like a great.
That's fine with me.
Yeah.
Little bit of montage.
Yeah, ending on the word bastard.
Nice.
Yeah, I have an idea for a scene next time. So.
Great.
Make a note of it.
Yeah, I wrote it down. I want to get Althea to like demand an audience with Vigoya and Malavish at the same time.
Yeah.
And be like, nice. Be like, guess what? If you want my help, you need to confirm that I am who I say I am, or I don't have any actual power.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah, that sounds great.
Okay, so I guess let's do outros. Ash, Emily, Jason, then me, so I can do all our podcast outros. Like, you know, tell people where they could find you. Give a non-capitalist shout out if you have one that you would like to give. And yeah, take it away.
Yeah, I'm Ash. I'm a GM. I'm a game designer and a streamer. You can find me at CGIAK, A-C-E-G-I-A-K on Twitter, Twitch, YouTube, Instagram, Tumblr, and Patreon if you want to support my ongoing game design work. And if you, for a non-capitalist plug for today, I'm going to recommend Naps.
That's very good.
Hi, I'm Emily. I am a filmmaker and an artist. You can find me on Twitter at Blackwall Says. I also have a Patreon, patreon.com/blackwall. I've got a good one actually. My non-capitalist plug this week is I have just recently been thinking about like going and seeking new education and like and slightly changing my career path, and I would encourage everyone to like keep all your thoughts and options open, and remember that you can always like decide to do a new thing and learn new skills, and that is fun and exciting.
Sweet.
Hi, I'm Jason. I'm making this game, this exact game. And you can find me on Twitter at Manixur, M-A-N-I-X-U-R, and you will eventually and hopefully pretty soon be able to find me at that at some other places as well. And I also want to specifically plug Emily's art, because she did most of the art for this game, and it's fantastic, and you should like it. I also want to plug Ash's game, The Republic, because if what happened here wasn't really what you were expecting from an ancient world queer kind of thing, then the Republic might actually be what you were looking for. So probably take a look at that one.
Yeah, I like that they seem to inhabit like a similar kind of space, but they focus on very different things.
The
they
circles on the Venn diagram feeling. Touch.
It's really, yeah, exactly. It's really interesting.
It's really interesting. I also want to thank Aaron for making it possible for all of this to happen, because I don't know what's going on at all. And for a non-capitalist shout out, I want to say Amazon treats their workers horribly. So if you want something that you can get from a place other than Amazon, you should strongly consider doing that.
Indeed. Hi, I'm Aaron, as you can see by the little nameplate down there. I guess I'll start with the podcast stuff. So if you want to watch any of our past campaigns, you can go to youtube.com/thatdndpodcast or thatdndpodcast.com. We've got 4 years of audio on there, broken up by campaign, several different rule sets and all sorts of stuff. So there's definitely a lot in there. We have ongoing games on Tuesdays and Thursdays with the occasional extra game when I decide to throw the schedule out the window. If you want to follow me, I'm getting into game design. I'm doing a little bit of editing for people. I've got audio editing experience. I'm a general computer nerd. I do interviews and producery work. I also flirt with people and post pictures of food. So you can do, you can check me out on Twitter at theroadvirus_. I have a Twitch channel where I stream myself cooking and also like game dates and stuff. So that's twitch.tv/theroadvirus with underscores between the words. And if you stay tuned either of those when I do random stuff, I'll talk about it. And the non-capitalist shout out of the day is provide space for a person if you can today. Somebody who you care about. Ask them how their day was. Listen earnestly when they talk to you about it. Share in something that they're excited about. Talk with them through something they might be scared about. But just be there for another person, and it has the potential to do a lot more good than you think. So that's going to wrap it up for us tonight. Stay tuned to that D&D podcast on Twitter, where we will announce other sessions of things, and I think we should be back next week or sometime soon with another session of Stand in Defiance. So thank you, everybody, and have a good night.